We're very pleased to have tonight the first public presentation by Apple of two major new computers that one of which I think you will agree is truly revolutionary. It's a very, very significant breakthrough, and we're really very proud to have it here. We are very pleased to present David Larson, who is product marketing manager, and John Couch, who is vice president of the Personal Office Systems Division of Apple Computer, with two new Apples.
Hi. I'm really glad to be here. I'm Dave Larson. I'm the Apple IIe product manager. And I'm really pleased to be here. This is the first time we've been able to talk about the Apple IIe in public. And we've been talking a lot about it to our sales force and our reps and a lot of people internal to Apple. And this is really nice to be able to finally unveil it to the public. So we really feel good about this, and we really appreciate your being here. What I'd like to do, the first thing I'd like to know is how many of you are real familiar with the Apple II as it is now, or the II Plus, or are owners of the II Plus? Great. A good crowd. That's what I expected. I was hoping for that. What I would like to do tonight is just kind of give you an overview of the Apple II itself, in, you know, not the IIe, first of all, but just the II, where it started, how we've gotten to where we are, and then review why we decided to do the IIe. Because it was a very significant move for us internally at Apple to make this transition. And then I'd like to explain to you what some of the issues, just go through the features of the product briefly, and some of the issues that we came up with in terms of introducing this product. So if you could dim the lights and turn on the slides, I'd like to start. This is the test here. Okay, to start out, what I'd like you to do is just think about what it would have been like if you were Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak working in a garage in Mountain View, California in 76 and building a personal computer. You look about it in terms of who they were designing this product for, what the markets were going to be, what they perceived the potential to be. It's really, you know, it's pretty remarkable to think about that. Well, where those guys were at primarily, I don't mean to insult you, but the primary, you know, target for their market at that time was the Santa Clara Valley hobbyist. You know, if you knew what a soldering iron was and knew how to use it, and you knew how to program, you were the guy that they would have expected to buy that product. And they didn't, you know, clearly they didn't expect to see a huge number of sales of IIes. They were young guys, they didn't know what to expect. But you look at what happened, it's just really phenomenal. And it's in 77, Apple did, the first year when we introduced the product, we did about $750,000 in business. This year, we're going to be in the figure of $750,000,000. And it's, you know, John's going to tell you who's going to, you know, what's going to happen to Apple in the future with respect to our technologies. But if you look at this growth, it's almost exclusively due to the Apple II family. And the addition, you know, the software and hardware products that we're distributing associated with that product. It's been a phenomenal growth based on one product. This is a picture from one of our manufacturing facilities that produced the Apple II. We currently have subassembly in Singapore, which does all the subassembly work for the Apple II. We have a manufacturing plant in Dallas, which does most of our domestic building of the Apple IIs. And then we have an international plant in Cork, which does our 220-volt product. Right now, we're producing an Apple II at a rate of one every 20 seconds. And we're increasing that rate, obviously, with the IIe. This shows what it used to be like when we were producing Apple II Pluses in our burn-in process. Well, when you're building as many as we're doing, it takes a pretty big building to burn in a product in this form. So when we talk about the Apple IIe, you'll see some of the reasons from a manufacturing point of view in terms of why we've introduced this product. Again, when you look, you know, just kind of think in the context of the Jobs Wozniak days, you know, they designed that product to build in their garage. They didn't design that product to build 30 or 40 or 50,000 a month. Another really important element of what this product has done is it's created a whole industry around itself. And I'm sure a lot of you are participants in that industry you're very familiar with it. You know, there's been a whole series of hardware products. These represent some of the Apple products that we've come out for the Apple II. But, you know, there are thousands of programs, software programs on the Apple II, hundreds to thousands of hardware products. All focused that really focused around this product, and a lot of companies have gotten their origin around it. So when you look at the impact of this product, it's really dramatic. And for us to consider a change, you know, just think in that light of how significant the consideration is for us to do anything to change this product, to change such a successful product. You know, so it comes up the question, why did we want to change? And I'll tell you from internally, when you're sitting in our seat in Apple and you're looking at it and you've got your bread and butter product out there, you know, the question is, do you really want to mess with it? Do you really want to change that product? And we thought a lot and talked a lot about it, but it's clear that we needed to. And just I'll kind of go through the considerations we had. First of all, you look at what's occurred in the marketplace. I mean, right now, there are over 100 new products introduced on the market. And as you're all aware, it seems like every day there's another one. And there's a real advantage that the new products have had over us in terms of introduction is that now they can observe what the marketplace is, and they've been able to target their products very specifically at this generic marketplace. We targeted our product for the enthusiast. But now as new products come into the market, they're really specializing into various marketplaces, and there's a lot of new features there that we didn't know about. Another element which is really important is that the international marketplace is becoming very significant, both for Apple and for other companies. My previous work was in the European marketplace, and they're 2 to 3 years behind us. And historically, up to this time, an American or an English-speaking product, so to speak, has been very effective in that marketplace because it's been used primarily in multilingual companies or in areas where people speak English. But we're really seeing a transition in that area. And with the limitations of the Apple II with respect to the keyboard and number of keys available, you know, it's not very easy to do a German keyboard on the 2 Plus just because of the limitation of the keyboard. So the 2 Plus really, or the 2 or the 2 Plus, weren't really designed for that international marketplace. But really, most importantly, is to look at the markets that we're selling the 2 Plus into. I mean, look over on the left and you see the enthusiast. That represents a very small fraction of the overall market that we're selling into, the people who are buying the Apple IIs. It's still a very significant number, but in terms of those kinds of buyers, we're seeing a greater trend of the usefulness of the personal computer. You know, as you're all aware, as these applications have developed, the software and hardware programs, the Apple II has been a very useful tool in the business marketplace. It's really the largest, at this point, it's the largest selling computer into the business environment. And you look at all of these other marketplaces, and I'll just run through them briefly in terms of who these people are and why, you know, what the uses are these people have. You know, we've got the office marketplace with the professional managerial. They're using the productivity tools and the five concepts are very important. If you look at the Apple II Plus in that context, it's very difficult with the restrictions that keyboard offers. You know, in the very small business, it's a similar kind of restriction in terms of word processing or the kinds of applications that someone might use. These people are much more concerned, however, with, you know, financial data and accounting packages, which the Apple II Plus can serve, but it is also limited with certain of the restrictions of the product. You know, again, the home marketplace for the Apple II is one which was primarily in the area of people who are computer enthusiasts, but again, that's really evolving as more and more people want to become more computer literate, and they may want to run a computer to operate their business at home. And again, it's in educate the kids. There are a lot of applications that people want to move this product into the home, and the two has been well suited for that. The educational market is the other market which has been very significant for the Apple II and continues to be. And it's been a product very well suited for it. But again, there are limitations that we've had with this product that we've really felt that we needed to address. So in our minds, we've had a tremendous success with the Apple II. I mean, when you look at this industry, you know, it is I consider it, obviously, since I'm from Apple, the primary reason for the industry to evolve. We've had tremendous success. And what we're introducing now is the Apple IIe, which we consider the successor to the IIe, the 2 Plus. What our design objectives were when we designed the IIe and produced the IIe was to basically create a superset of the 2 Plus, to be able to have all the features of the 2 Plus, to maintain compatibility with that product, but to take, you know, the technology of the 80s and build it into the 2E in terms of using the technology available, and also to add those features which are required in the marketplace today, which really weren't there before. So what we've done is we really looked at it very closely, and that, you know, we determined that we needed to upgrade the product to really fulfill the market needs of the 80s and to carry the two into the 80s with the tremendous base of software and hardware products we've got with this product. We really see that it's going to be a product that's going to live a long time. You know, it's kind of like the Model T. I don't know if I should equate it to that, but it's one of those products. It's going to be one that will live a long time. And we wanted to enhance it so that it really meets the requirements and we can improve it for the 80s. What I'd like to do is to walk you through the differences between the 2 Plus and the 2E. And I'd just like to focus into three areas because that's clearly where you're going to see the differences. And since so many of you are familiar with the Apple II, I mean, it'll be very clear for you to see as we go through the 2E the dramatic differences we've got. And the three areas we want to focus on are first the keyboard, the changes in the logic board, which is, and then the back panel design, the design, overall design of the product with respect to ease of use. First of all, the keyboard. And all of you know and love, now, you know the Apple II Plus keyboard. You probably don't love the keyboard. I don't know how many Boston Computer Society members have committed suicide because they missed return and hit reset. But, you know, there are probably a few of those. There are not too many people that have loved our word processing programs with the 2 Plus. And, you know, there are a lot of other things. If you like a complete ASCII set, you know, you missed it. And there's, you know, there are a lot of other things which aren't so sweet about the product, but look at when those guys built it. You know, 76, if you were a computer programmer, the only thing around was a teletype keyboard. It made sense. It made total sense. But that's not the market anymore. You'll also see another subtle thing I'll just mention is you see where the 2 Plus logo is. Well, that's a minor point, but we've shifted the logo. That's about the only physical difference in terms of the appearance of the 2E. But the main appearance difference is that of the keyboard. And I'll just quickly run through some of those features for you. First of all, it's a Selectric style keyboard. And we really put a lot of work and design effort into this keyboard. I know that the engineering product manager, I mean, for a month I saw him running around with a keyboard under his arm, and everybody saw it, says, try this. You know, so we did a lot of experimentation on what people found to be a comfortable keyboard. And we really, and so what we settled on was a Selectric style design. So it's for somebody who's migrating from a typewriter to a 2E, it's a very simple transition. They know where to look for the keys. Another important element is now we have a complete ASCII set. So we've moved up so that we now have that complete capability. Some of the other keys which are really nice, you know, if you notice to the right, I'm going to move over so I'll just point. If you look, we've moved the reset key out of your way so we don't have that problem which I alluded to. We've added one new key, which is a delete key, and several of the new applications available on the 2E will utilize this. You'll notice we've got a tab key. We now have full cursors on the 2E. You'll notice there's now a caps lock in the lower left hand. Some applications, 2 Plus applications, require that the caps lock be down so that I don't want to say it emulates the 2, but it's essentially a 2 keyboard once you put the caps lock in place. A couple of new keys also, two more, are the 2 Apple keys. The biggest failure that we currently have on the 2 Plus is the power switch. That's the thing that fails most frequently. So what we've got now is if you press Control, Open Apple Reset, the system goes to what we call a warm reboot. It's essentially, you know, if you used to flip the power switch on and off to get you out of an application, you now have that option. If you do a control closed Apple reset, the machine goes through total self-diagnostics and will come up and tell you if the machine's okay or if there's a problem, what the problem is with respect to the ICs, if there are any failures. So we really focus heavily on keyboard redesign. And from an appearance point of view, that's really a dramatic difference. And with the new applications that are being developed on the 2E, we'll see that the utilization of this keyboard is coming very quickly with lots of new software applications. The next area of difference is in the main logic board. This is really the heart of the machine. We have taken all the electronics, for instance, the keyboard encoder is now built into the main logic board. All the electronics of the machine are now on the board. The overall chip count from the Apple II Plus to the 2E has been reduced from 110 ICs to 31. We accomplished that primarily. strength that we have in the IC business. We've got a lot of people who have come out of that business, and you'll see that this is really where the Apple II is evolving into the technology of the 80s with the VLSI technology. We're really evolving and enhancing this product. You know, what does it mean with respect to that? Well, first of all, the reliability of the 2E is greater than that of the 2 Plus. And the 2 Plus is really one of the most reliable products around. Our early test data on some of our early machines showed a mean time between failure of about 2 years. The more recent machines, on our international version, we had no failures on 100,000 hours of testing. So what we're seeing is very, very reliable product, much greater than we had with the 2 Plus. And we really see that to be a great enhancement with 2E in terms of reliability. The machine is also a 64K machine, in terms of 64K resident. And we achieve that through the 64K chips here, whereas before we were using 16K chips. Again, if we're moving to the newer technologies, not in terms of the 6502, which is still the same processor, which we need to retain because of the product, to maintain the same product, but we did move to new technologies in terms of the product. Also, one thing to note here, and I didn't mention on the keyboard, is the international considerations. We currently, on introduction, the Apple IIe is currently available in the dealerships around the United States, and it's also available internationally. And in the international marketplace, we've introduced the Apple IIe with full documentation in French and German, as well as English. And we've also got a different keyboard and a different logic board in the international marketplace. The keyboard internationally meets ISO standards, and the main logic board, instead of having the NTSC video circuitry resonant, it's got PAL circuitry. So that is another major element which we wouldn't see in the United States as an impact with respect to the Apple II, but it's a very strong element internationally. We're also supporting 15 additional languages with the Apple IIe, and that's accomplished by changing two ROMs, which are the keyboard encoder ROM and the character generator. So what we're doing is actually you change those two ROMs and keycaps in an international market, you have a bilingual machine. The international machines has two character sets resident. And by merely flipping a switch, it can be in either English or in another language. It's the only product that does that, and we're really proud of that for the international marketplace. But there are several other things. One is that of the auxiliary connector. And what I'd like to point out is you'll see, except for slot zero, which is no longer present, the reason for that is we built in the language card. The machine is 64K resident. So we've eliminated slot zero. The other slots are the same, and the signals remain the same. What we've also done is added a new slot, which we call the auxiliary connector. We're using that. There are two products that we're introducing with it. One is an 80-column text card, and a second is an 80-column card with an additional 64K of memory. Those products are introduced and available now. So essentially, you can have 128K Apple IIe. This auxiliary connector is also used by our service department in that it has all the signals available on the board are brought off of this connector. So what we're doing is we have self-diagnostic ROM cards which we can use if there are any problems associated with the product. You're also going to see, starting next month, new products coming out which use this auxiliary connector, and our one product is an 80-column 64K CPM card. And there are other RGB cards, several additional cards which will be coming out utilizing this new slot. So there are new products, again, like the old Apple II, we're going to see this kind of evolution with the 2E in terms of new products being available using the features of the product. The back panel is the other area of change. You know, again, you go back to 76. There wasn't an FCC which was concerned about radio emissions from home computers. The FCC was there, but that concern wasn't. So when these guys built this product, you know, they built this so you could put cables on the back. That was their main design criteria. But it isn't easy to meet FCC criteria. And for those of you who are familiar with the current 2 Plus and some of what we call our funky boxes and outhouses to connect peripherals to ground the product, it's kind of a kludge solution. So what we've done with the 2E is we've really modified dramatically the appearance and the effect of the back panel. What we're doing now is the base pan wraps around and comes up to the back panel. You see these, the numbered slots which I'm pointing to, what those are small plastic clips. They pop out and expose DB-style slots. Those are designed, and there are also small holes to, so that if you insert a peripheral card, just with a set screw, you can lock it in place. And all the slots are designed to accommodate that. And so you'll see an evolution in the short term and longer term of peripheral cards moving to this type of design. So that peripheral, so when a dealer sells the system, he can configure it, put the peripheral cards in place, secure the cards, and when a user takes it home, all he's got to do is externally plug in a connector. He doesn't have to go into the inside of the machine. For most people in this room, it's probably not an issue. But if you're a computer naive person, like most of the current buyers are, it is an issue. So we made that modification. Also, you'll see there's a DB9 externally, which is for hand controllers and game and joysticks, numeric keypads, which is available. You can still use the old style. We still left the connectors in the machine available, so if you have an old joystick, you can still use it on the 2E. But if you buy a new product, it's more suitable to hook on externally. So we made that kind of change. Also, it's not real clear from this slide, but in building the Apple IIe, if you build in our manufacturing facility, they have to flip over the Apple II Plus 7 times to build it when you're building it. And if you've ever tried to take out your keyboard, you know how difficult it may be. So what we've done with the 2E is I've got kind of a neat story. The first 2Es we built in a warehouse. You know, I feel kind of like we went back to the garage days, and we still could do that. Because if you build from the 2E, what we do is we do extensive pre-burn-in of the product, the printed circuit board. All the electronics are on the board. When we build this product, we start at the bottom up. You put the base pan on, the main logic board goes on. The keyboard mounts to the base pan, and it's all built up. The last thing that goes on is the case. Also, if you look at the size of that main logic board, it's the same size as the case, so you've got total exposure to all the components. We've really designed it for ease of use, ease of repair, ease of manufacture, some of the primary considerations. You know, there were a lot of considerations in terms of how you build this machine, how somebody will use it, and those are the kinds of considerations that we incorporated in the design of the product. Another very important element of the 2E introduction and the 2E itself is how we finally taken this opportunity to integrate the presentation of the Apple IIe or the Apple II in terms of the manuals, software, and all our documentation. What's shown here is what you get inside the 2E box. The first thing you get is an owner's manual, which has totally been redone. And it's a very easy to read, easy to use manual. It's for the computer naive person. It's, you know, right now if you open an Apple II Plus, you get a technical reference manual, an Apple Soft reference manual, and an Apple Soft tutorial. And if you're a computer naive person, it's rather intimidating. And so what we've done is we've really taken that and provided a very easy to use, easy to read manual. We've also included in the package a 2E, Apple IIe intro to the product keyboard disk jet, which we've got running on, you may be curious, as it recycles. So what we've got is for the computer naive person, he takes the product home, he can very easily understand the product with respect to reading the manual, and he immediately has something he can work with which to familiarize himself with the product and the keyboard. You'll also see that we have rewritten our technical reference manuals, the AppleSoft manuals, we've produced the new 80 column card manuals. All of them follow the same kind of strategy or presentation. The manuals, if you open the cover, you know, it basically says how much do you want to learn. And it really walks you through that manual in terms of if you just want to learn this much, you read this chapter. And depending on the level of knowledge that you want, this is how you go through these manuals. Because we're finding that most people who buy the product only utilize a certain percentage of it, you know, a small percentage of the total functionality of it. And we want to let those people, if that's what they want to do, to be able to just read that portion of the manual. We've had too much, we don't have the opportunities. You're going to see what John gives us, the other one, Lisa. It's a tremendous tool that we've got in terms of this product. With the 2E, we still have the same hardware and software capabilities, but we are really trying to improve our user interface in terms of the manuals, the way we present materials. You know, and the other thing that I want to focus on is that of the software. You know, when the 2 came out, you didn't need software because there were no computers, so it was just we were trying to sell a computer. In today's age, you really need a product which supports, you need a hardware product, but you also need the software products to support it. And what we looked at, the three, you know, when you look at the elements, the first thing we had to do was to ensure that our product was compatible to the Apple II and the Apple II Plus. The next thing that we wanted to do was to evolve some new software products which utilize the new features of it. And we also wanted to work very, very closely with the software developers or vendors who develop these software products, which really help us sell the Apples. And that's one of the main things that I'm really pleased with in terms of our product introduction, in terms of how we've been able to work with developers. With respect to compatibility, we've done an extensive amount of testing of software products. Beginning last May, we started sending 2Es to major software developers and OEMs around the United States and around the world, actually, to have them test their products on a 2E so that we could really measure the compatibility of the product. We thought we knew exactly what we had and we wanted to confirm that, which we have done. What we found was that about 95% of the products that we have tested or the developers have tested work just fine on the Apple IIe. Those products which don't work, the 5%, I think I can fit into a couple of categories. In terms of hardware products, it's those products which you were exclusive to slot zero don't work, obviously, since there's no slot zero. The second type of category of cards which may not work are, for instance, 80 column cards which require that you pull a chip and use the piggyback. Since we have redesigned the main logic board, the same chips may not be available. In terms of software products that were not, that we had compatibility issues with, it's kind of the only ones that were not compatible were those products in which people didn't follow documented and standard monitor ROM routines. So if people tried to cheat, their products may not work. By and large, you know, we've got a total compatibility, you know, we've got large compatibility. What we did is we did the testing with developers in terms of having them test their software. We hired then an independent consulting firm, and we provided them with lots of software products. And we had an independent group testing the products because we really felt it was important that we didn't bias the test results. In any products that we found that there was a compatibility question, we talked to developers to ensure that we could work with them so that when the 2E was released, their products would be compatible. So we've been really working very closely on an ongoing basis with people that have existing products on the 2E or on the 2 Plus to work with them so their products could be ensure that they were compatible on the 2E. And we're really pleased with the results that we've had. And the response so far in the last couple of weeks of our product being on the market has been, it's confirmed that assumption. The next element was that of providing new products that use the enhanced features. At Apple, we made a decision to introduce two products, and that's Apple Writer and QuickFile. It's our word processing database products. And they use all the new features of the 2E. They use the function keys, the additional 64K, the cursors, etc. We also wanted to introduce those products in mind with the new documentation strategy, where we also provide tutorials for people to use and a very easy-to-use reference manual for the product. We feel it's real important to simplify the introduction of new users to the computer. Also, there are several other new products from a lot of different developers which utilize the new 2E functions. What we did is we worked with those major developers who are responsible for the sales of the 2s to ensure, you know, to have them work with us to upgrade their products so that they could co-introduce with us when we introduced our product last week. And a lot of your popular products like VisiCalc, PFS, Multiplan, a lot of some of the new word processing programs have been upgraded so they use the 2E features. So that was another focus that we've really been working very closely to ensure that the 2E that there are new products on the 2E which utilize these features. And some of those are on the market now, and there are a lot of them coming that you're going to be seeing in the near future. The same thing is applicable, as I indicated before, with a lot of the hardware peripheral devices, which are migrating to the new type B connector strategy. The products work just fine as they are, but they're just migrating now for ease of use for the consumer. So all in all, you know, in summary about the 2E, we've really tried to ensure that we can maintain compatibility with the product, that we created a superset of the Apple II, but really added to that the enhanced technologies of the 80s, which we have done. And, you know, in closing, what I'd like to say is that there are still more people doing more things in more places with Apples than with any other computer in the world. And this is the year we're going to pass 1 million unit sales for two Apple II products. So I'm really looking forward to that day, and that's coming sooner than we could really believe. And we think that the install base of the Apple II is going to ever grow, and we're really looking forward to it. And, you know, we hope you enjoy the product, and for all of you 2+ we hope you move up. So that's my sales pitch. So I thank you a lot. If there are any questions, we'll handle them after John gets done talking about Lisa, and we'll handle any questions that you may have at that time. So thanks a lot.
At least we're inside. There's a whole hell of a lot of people waiting outside to still get in. But what I'd like to do is start off with a few quotes. May change forever the way people communicate with machines. Time Magazine. A remarkable technological achievement. Newsweek. Simply put, Lisa ushers in a second generation of personal computers. Eric Weil. The first thing I've seen that justifies the word revolutionary, DataQuest. And clearly a milestone product. After Lisa, the professional computing world will never be the same again, the Siebold Report. What I'd like to do tonight is kind of give you a glimpse of the product that these people are talking about. Let me spend less time talking and sort of more time showing. But before we sort of get into the demo, I'd like to share with you a little bit sort of the history of the product, because that's sort of a story in itself. I joined Apple in mid-78 when we were, for the first time, attempting to prove to the world that the personal computer market really existed. That market grew out of hardware technology, as all of you know. I tell the story that when I left grad school in Berkeley in 1972, I bought a home in the valley there for $27,000, and a computer of the power of today's Apple IIe was selling for about $200,000. You can't find a house in the valley now for $200,000. So it's a very visual way of seeing what hardware technology has done over the last 10 years. And what we're going to talk about tonight is the software technology. And software technology that has been developed over the last couple of years, and in particular taking advantage of some of this evolving hardware technology. So I joined Apple in 78, and Steve and I sort of did some blue skying in the last part of 1978 that says, look, we know that this personal computer market is growing. It's going to emerge out of the hardware technology. We know that we're going to have 16 and 32-bit machines. We know we're going to have megabytes of memory, 2 megabytes of memory. You know, what are we going to do in the 1980s? Are we going to run the same damn software that we ran on maxis and then minis and then on micros? Or are we going to look, you know, to really attempt to solve some problems? And so we started talking about systems that were easy to use, systems that were integrated. And to kind of help you kind of get into the way of thinking that we have, I brought a film tonight, which is only a 7-minute sort of video slideshow that we did for the salespeople. We did it for internal reasons. We wanted to be able to communicate to our own internal salespeople last October in Acapulco. What was this product all about? And how did it, you know, how did it come about? And who pushed for it? And where was it going? And so I'd like to start, if you will, with that, and then kind of come back, you know, give you a little bit more personal feeling for what went on in Apple and how this thing transpired. And then we'll get in and sort of talk about what we have here tonight. So, John, can I fire up this film?
The cluttered desk, index cards, file folders, the in-out basket, the calculator. These are the tools of the office professional's past. Since the dawn of the computer age, better machines have always meant bigger and more powerful. But the software could not accommodate the needs of office professionals who are responsible for the look, shape, and feel of tomorrow, the decision makers. Until now, they have only been visitors to the information age. Today, there is a personal office system that presents the familiar environment of their desktop and combines it with the simple, natural ways in which professionals do their work. Presenting Lisa, a 16-bit dual disk drive personal office system from Apple Computer. Lisa, integrated software with a common user interface. Lisa, the next revolution in computing.
The breakthrough of the Lisa program is the software technology. The use of graphics to emulate the way an individual works in an office environment. And a software architecture that allows us to integrate the typical functions of a personal computer. Word processing, modeling, business graphics, database management, and datacom.
Lisa began as the dream of key Apple executives, Steve Jobs, Mike Markala, and John Couch. Then Apple had to build it.
If you sort of dig beneath the surface, one of the real successes of the Lisa program was creating an environment where all these crazy people that could really be very, very successful. And I guess that's one of the things that Apple's done best.
Engineer Rich Page pushed for the first critical decision, the selection of the 16-bit MC68000 as the CPU.
Along with the 68000, one of the things that you have is a larger address capability. So you're not limited to a smaller amount of memory. Lisa typically would have upwards of half a megabyte of memory.
It was really the only chip that had a sufficient address space that we could write programs of this size and have an architecture that would last us over a period of at least a decade, which we felt was very important.
The power of the MC68000 permitted another breakthrough, the common user interface.
On Lisa, we make each of the programs have a similar user interface, so what you've learned from using one program carries over and you feel naturally how to use the next.
A key element in the common user interface is the mouse, an ingenious cursor positioning device that makes using the system as easy as point and press.
In the design of Lisa, we chose to use graphical menu items instead of word commands that you type in because it's a lot easier to learn. Instead of remembering a whole long list of commands and remembering how to spell each correctly and all of those things, we just present a picture of a menu of options, and to choose one, you just point at it with a mouse, and it's really easy to learn. Take, for example, a graphics editor. My 10-year-old niece walked up to my machine and started playing with it, and in 5 minutes, she knew how to use the graphics editor, and she stored off her picture and printed it out. That's what's so beautiful about Lisa, is anybody can use it.
Lisa is the only personal office system to offer word processing, electronic spreadsheet capabilities, business graphics, list management, complex scheduling, and graphics editing in one integrated software package. The bitmap display feature permits the user to choose a multitude of typefaces and fonts, and to draw virtually any composition imaginable. An interactive tutorial program, Apple Guide, introduces the basic concepts necessary to use Lisa. Because Lisa is such a revolutionary design concept, Apple built a special sneak room to preview Lisa to corporate executives. The reaction of the executives?
An individual from one of the larger corporations, after having viewed Lisa, commented to me, "You know, there's only been two revolutions in the computer industry, the transistor, the invention of the integrated circuit, and I think I just saw the third."
The design and construction of Lisa took more than 200 man-years of development, testing, and debugging. Hundreds of thousands of hours were dedicated to creating an office system that would incorporate the simplest and most natural interface ever developed. More than 30 million Americans and millions more abroad work in offices. Executives and managers in the accounting, marketing, financial, engineering, and planning professions are the prime targets of the Lisa marketing push. IBM, Xerox, and others appear to be formidable competitors, but none can match Lisa's innovative, versatile, and low-cost features. The office is the computer market of the future. Like the personal computer market of 1977, the office represents an extremely large and untapped market. Lisa is years ahead, setting the standards for the future of office software technology. Lisa will be the flagship of the Apple product line. The Apple II serves the needs of those who need a small home unit for work or personal use. The Apple III serves the small business marketplace. Lisa will address the needs of the knowledge workers, the corporate executives, and professional personnel.
You can describe Lisa verbally until you're blue in the face, and you won't have nearly the impact of letting somebody sit down and play with it. Once somebody sits down and plays with a Lisa, they're hooked. Lisa is by far and away the most ambitious technical undertaking that Apple's ever attempted, and it really is the most massive investment of dollars and human resources and really risk since we did the Apple II. With the Apple II, we had all of $1,300 to lose. But I think what we've done is, again, really put all our chips back on the table and said, we're willing to bank the company on this, on what we believe is the future direction of personal computing. I think it's fair to say that everyone working on the Lisa program and everyone outside of the program that's seen the product wants one, at least one.
Lisa, Apple's demonstration of its leadership in bringing technology to the knowledge worker. Lisa, the personal office system of tomorrow. Hear from Apple today.
I think there is an important thing that Phil, sort of Steve mentioned, that is, I think you'll find sort of a common theme throughout Apple, that we sort of build products that we ourselves want, we want as an individual. And I think it's important to sort of point out that I've been involved in product in the past that, similar to this, I think the first product that sort of this gut feeling that I'm seeing history repeating again. But the first product that I was associated with like this was the HP 35. If you go back to the early 1970s and you remember this 395-4 function calculator. Well, I was at HP at that time. We'd spent a ton of money going out and doing a market research analysis on whether or not the market was ready for this new technology called this 4 function calculator. And the marketing research group came back and said, don't build it because nobody wants it. And Bill Hewlett said, well, hey, I want it, and in fact, I want it to fit in my top pocket, so we're going ahead with the product. Needless to say, I think we can all look back and the impact that product had in society in the 1970s. In fact, I think the largest slide rule company at the time when the HP 35 was introduced was out of business 18 months later, because they didn't see that particular technology coming. I think it's similar with the original Apple II. You know, Steve and Woz wanted to build that. They wanted that product for themselves. If they hadn't been a garage operation, they probably would have gone out and commissioned a marketing research group. And I'm convinced that group would have come back in 1976 and said, don't build a personal computer because nobody wants it. And I'll admit I may have even been one of those people in 1976. What am I going to do with a personal computer? Not really understanding the technology at that time. And this product exhibits all of the same types of reactions and stuff. As we ran 100 people through 100 different companies through these sneak programs, I, for the last 18 months, have been trying to describe something to people without showing it to them. And that's been a very difficult process. And we would bring these people in and we would talk about the technology and how the personal computer market has grown out of hardware technology, and we would talk about this new market called the personal office system. And their reaction at first would always be the same. Well, what is a personal office system, and why do I need a personal office system, and you know, really, what is this software technology that you're talking about? The reaction would turn around 180 degrees after they had the opportunity to sit down and use the machine. I think that was best demonstrated last week. Steve and I were in New York, for press tours, and one of the fellows that we were giving a presentation to sort of, you know, didn't really understand what this software technology, you know, what's software technology, and didn't quite understand what we were talking about until he actually sat down and used the machine. And you know, he said, I came in here thinking that I knew everything there was to know about the Lisa system, and obviously I knew nothing. And he says, do you guys realize what you've done? And I said, well, we think so, you know. And he says, you've just built the first manual transmission computer. And I said, well, what do you mean like that? He says, well, my grandmother never could drive until manual transmissions came. He said, you've just built the first computer that my grandmother can use. So with that, I think what we'll do is we'll show you, talk a little bit about, and rather than spending a lot of time talking, we're going to kind of do a concurrent process here, a multi-process environment, where we're going to sort of walk through the demo, the live talk, and explain the things. The two most important things as I get into this to remember, I want to go over and I'll keep hitting on, in terms of this software technology, is the user interface and the integration. And I'm going to refer to an architecture, a software architecture. Wayne referred to a software architecture that's going to live for a decade. And very simply, what we mean by a software architecture is it's like a home. It's the way it's built, and it's what it looks like to the outside user. Is it an English tutor? Is it a French country? So when we refer to the software architecture of Lisa, we really refer to two things. The user interface, which is more than just the graphics and what you see on the screen. But it includes the mouse and a number of other things. And the architecture, the other aspect of that architecture is the way it's built in terms of the independent processes, sharing information, creating data structures such that we can pass text, independent of whether that's numerics or text or graphic, to pass data back and forth. And so let's just kind of get started and then sort of focus, first of all, on one of the aspects of the user interface. One of the things that we came to the conclusion very early in the game, when we took a look at those 32.5 million people out there, professional, knowledgeable workers in the office environment, and I think we're about 800,000 personal computers, Apple is at this point in time, we realized that we hadn't even dented the market. We hadn't even touched it. And that, what was the reason for that? We came to the conclusion that the reason for that was the systems were just very difficult to use, too hard to use. And we couldn't ask those very busy, knowledgeable workers to dedicate 15, 20, 30 hours to learn how to use a function, and then another 20 hours to learn how to use a second function, and then at the same time say, oh, by the way, there's no way to get the data from that function into another function, so you may have to recreate it or retype it. So the first thing that we decided to do was to focus on making a system that was easier to use. And in doing that, we decided that we ought to emulate the way an individual works rather than asking them to change the way they do things to use a computer. And very quickly, we moved from that brilliant idea to graphics. And we said, why don't we create graphic objects and images that they're already familiar with rather than asking them to learn a foreign language? And the command interpreters and command languages are as foreign as you can get. And you know, people sort of, they have to learn these command languages, they have to learn what the commands are, whether it's parentheses, or whether it's commas, or whether it's periods. And it sort of freaks them out because if they type in the wrong thing, the system goes off and interprets it and does some crazy things. So the first thing, what we have on the screen is sort of what we call the desktop. The gray area there is a desktop, and on your desktop you will find certain objects that you're familiar with. First of all, there's the Lisa system itself. And as Doug pulled that up, and you can take a look at that. That's one object. You've got a calculator object. You've got clock objects. You've got a trash can for deleting files and documents. You know, people laugh about it. I had a call from, I think it was one of the major publications, and the message was real simple, and it said, hey, I want to learn more about this trash can. People seem to get really excited about that. There's the file cabinet down in the right-hand corner. But basically, you have objects. You can pick those objects around. You can move them around any place in your desktop. And then you can open those objects. And we're going to open sort of the file cabinet there. And just to kind of show you, the menu bar at the top of the screen is the command structure, and we've just opened the file cabinet, and as you can see the contents of the file cabinet, it includes documents and folders. And that's the other aspect of the system. You only need to think about three things. You need to think about documents, different types of documents, whether they're word processing documents or documents that have lists of information or documents that have business graphics or documents that have organizational charts or documents that have schedules. You think of a document goes into a folder, folders can be stored in the folders, and folders can be stored in the file cabinets. And if you can remember those three simple things, then you can use this system. Now, I mentioned the menu bar at the top. That will change depending on the type of document that you're working on. So if you're working on a word processing document, you'll get the functions for that particular, for the capabilities available to you to operate on that document, et cetera, et cetera. So this is the desktop. If you open the Lisa system, for instance, that's how you would set the tone of the screen, the loudness, if you will, of your speaker, the delay on your keys. That's how you would configure the system. All very straightforward, all graphical in nature. Again, nothing to remember, no commands to memorize. And as you can just see an example of that. And then we can close down the Lisa system by going to either the menu bar and saying closing Lisa, or there's a shortcut which Doug will use tonight, and that's double clicks. Double clicks on the mouse will open and close documents. So as you can see, the first aspect of our software technology or of our software architecture was the user interface, if you will, doing away with the traditional command interpreter. And it's interesting to take a second here and to realize that from a theoretical standpoint, a command interpreter is a programming language. You know, command interpreter is implemented in the same fashion as a basic compiler or a Pascal compiler. And what we have done here is we have created a totally graphic, totally iconic language. And that's, you know, that's something I just like to point out because I think it says something about at least one direction that we can take in terms of the future, in terms of languages, in terms of using computers. Okay, so there isn't much else to say as far as the command interpreter. If you understand documents and folders, what we can do is if you want to make a backup copy of a particular document, if you want to store that, you simply push the diskette into one of the slots in the system there, and you will get a graphical symbol. We'll go ahead and put the disk in there, and you'll see now that I have an icon representing disk one. If I were to put a floppy in the second drive, I would get an icon representing disk two. I can now open that icon so that I can see the contents of what's on that disk. In this particular case, I can see that there's folders. I can open one of those folders to see what type of documents are in there, and so on. Now, the way to store a document on the system or the way to store a folder is simply by picking up that folder or picking up that document and laying it on the icon for disk one. The way of taking the folder and storing it to the file cabinet in terms of the profile is simply to do that. So there's no commands for load and store. It's all a sequence of simply moving your documents or your folders to the appropriate file cabinet, and then we can move that around like everything else. So with that, I think the best thing to do is you kind of get a feeling for the use of the mouse in terms of selecting an object, opening the object, closing the object, moving the object to either store, print, or whatever. And at this particular time, what I'd like to do, and as we push the button that says, give me my diskette back, the system will make sure that we close all the files down and that your data is preserved before it will give you your floppy back. It will keep it until its integrity is valid. Now, at this particular time, I think what we'd like to do is kind of walk through some of the applications and let Doug open some of the applications, talk about the user interface of those applications, again, which you'll find is the same as in the desktop. We're going to move some data from applications to get an idea of the integration in terms of how we take data from one system to another. We're not going to spend a lot of time in terms of the functionality of each one of those applications, but I'll interject here and there and just sort of you know, comment on some of the things that I think that you may be interested in. So with that, Doug, you want to go ahead?
Said, you have two ways of opening any folder. One is to double-click on it, which is a bit of a shortcut, although you can always go to the file print menu and ask it to open or close a document. And those activities are always done in a generic fashion, no matter what environment you're in within Lisa. First thing we'd like to do is open a schedule that we put together concerning a hypothetical project called the Opus Project. And all six of these documents are concerning that project, and we'll work around with them a little bit.
Again, you notice that Doug simply selects the particular document that he's interested in and then says open that document. There is no run command. You just open the document and the appropriate application software is now loaded.
Just to give you an idea of the size of the project, we've got a folder here and all the folders can be manipulated in the same way. I can grab this little grow box here and change the size of it, shrink it down, and move it around the screen to any place else that I would like.
So the folders work, you know, the windows work the same way, and simply pointing to them activates them, and you can pick them up and move them around on your desk. In fact, we have 686 machines in use in our division right now, and you can walk around to an engineer's desk, and if an engineer keeps a real messy desk with papers piled up and folders and books and everything, you sort of look at his Lisa or his electronic desk, and you'll see that he will have between 15 and 20 different folders and documents opened up. And people like myself who, you know, sort of keep everything in the right-hand corner, the left-hand corner, all nice and neat, looks like I know what I'm doing, I tend to do the same thing on the system. And in fact, we provided help on the system. We have both a capability that says straighten up my desk and a capability that says put everything on my desk away, which we can show you a little bit later.
The Lisa project itself is designed around the critical path method way of scheduling projects. And just to give you an idea of the size of this project, we can go to the page layout menu and ask it to reduce the fit. And it will reduce the project down so that it can be illustrated.
Well, the complete Lisa development schedule was put on this system. In fact, this one was an afterthought. We got about halfway down through our software schedule and said, geez, we need a perk chart. And so we decided to develop one. And we, as you can see, and Doug will point out, it is very graphical and it is very easy. It's the only scheduling package that I have ever been able to use in my 10 years or 15 years actually of managing software where I could get the results before the software guys slip the project.
One of the things you'll notice about the project is some of the circles and boxes are darkened, and that's to illustrate the critical path of your project. We can go back and
leave that
to the original.
Yeah, leave that for a second. I want to make one comment on that. Go ahead and fire that guy back up. One of the things that's part of this architecture that I'd like to come back and sort of summarize on is the printing capability. And why don't you fire up the whole schedule and show them how that would be printed out. You know, in terms of the page thing. The print capabilities, what you see is what you get. We can print both horizontally and vertically, so we can print this complete schedule out. We have a little command there, pull down menu command, that will actually show how that schedule gets printed out. And it'll divide the page up. It'll say, this portion goes on this page, this portion goes on this page, this portion goes on that page. So it's typical of the way we use the system. It's traditionally graphic-oriented, and you can actually see that. But go ahead and proceed.
Again, the way the project scheduler is set up is it's got milestone circles and task boxes that represent tasks, and you can assign a name to the task. A person will be performing it and a time schedule for them to perform it, and it will calculate the critical path and show you the time the project has to start and finish. One of the nice things about this application is that it's very easy to modify a PER chart. And for those of you who've done this on paper and pencil, it's very, very difficult when you're actually doing it yourself to make modifications and see what the impact is on the critical path. And we could easily create a new task over here. And one of the things that's interesting to note is we've been working on this for about 10 minutes now, and this is the first time I've touched the keyboard. And what I'd like to do is name this task reschedule and assign a person to actually do the task. And why don't we assign Stephen and give him 3 days to do the task. Now what we need to do is put it in the per chart. And the way you manipulate an object is the same way you manipulate any objects in the Lisa environment. You actually point at it and move it to where you want it and then let up on the mouse. And so I can take this one over here and move it there. Now what I need to do is actually take this other box and insert it into the critical path. And the way I do that is with two functions which are fairly consistent through Lisa, and those are cut and paste. What I want to do is select this line, the first thing. So I point at it, and they go to the edit menu. And I have a couple choices, some very simple choices, cut, copy, or paste. And so what I'll do is cut out that line and move this guy back into where I want it, and now add the lines to put it in the critical path. And now it'll update. Now in doing that, it's updated all my dates for me so that I, on an ongoing basis, I can manipulate my schedule and always know where I am. One of the other things which is really nice about this application is it not only will give you a graphical way of, you know, working on your project, but also lets you look at the resources that are assigned to the project. And what you can go is go over here and ask for a resource chart. And what it'll do is give you the equivalent of a Gantt chart by resource, by person. So you can see what that person's going to be doing for however long the project's going on.
You can now see Stephen down there, right?
And you can now see Stephen down here with this new task pre-schedule that I added onto his. Originally, he was starting at the beginning here. And you also can see these shaded areas where people have slack time. So you can look at your resource chart and know. Know who you got yet.
We used all the slack time we could get.
You can also have it illustrated as a task chart where it'll go task by task and show you who's assigned and what their schedules look like. And then easily move back between the environments very quickly.
One of the things that I think that's interesting in this particular package is what we've done here is we've used the features of the system, that is the graphics and the user interface, and we've designed a piece of software that has been traditionally very difficult to use, very hard to use. And I think this is what, this particular package alone excited the Fortune 1000. They've seen word processors and they've seen spreadsheets, but they've never seen package like this with this kind of capability, with this ease of use on almost any machine, much less a personal office system or personal computer. And we have people who, one of the guys commented and says, we'll sell 1,000 machines to us alone just based on that capability alone. And we can actually take that graphics and cut that graphics over to another one of our packages to continue to annotate that, but we'll get into that. You opened the document for spreadsheet.
Yes. What I did was just, now that we've got the project outlined, we had put together a tentative budget for the project in Lisa Calc, which is our spreadsheet application. And the document's set up, and it looks very typical to, very similar to a lot of spreadsheets. And there are a few things about it that are kind of interesting to notice. One is that in order to modify any cell, all you have to do is move to the cell. And notice that the little cursor has changed. Depending on what application you're in, it will change to a style that's most appropriate. In selecting cells, it's a cross. In selecting text, it's just a little line. It's very, very friendly in that way. Select a cell, and whenever you select anything, it uses reverse video to show you that you selected it. And let's say I want to change the number of employees working on this project. All I'd have to do is enter the number of employees, and it will go, and it'll illustrate the cells that it's changing by shading them and then coming back. And notice automatically my total has been updated, my budget, and the excess or deficit based on formulas that I've already put into the application. Formulas are always illustrated whenever you click on a cell up here in the formula line, so you always know when you're looking at a particular cell what formula was used to create it. In addition, we've got some assumptions down here which are driving some of the expense categories up here. One has to do with the percent salary per quarter for benefits. And we can make that pretty typical number for a lot of corporations. You say it's 24, and they'll go and modify everything based on that. You can come over here and add some expenses to the project, let's say $900 per employee. Now, one of the things you'll just notice as it's updated that is that in the total line, we've got a set of stars here, which illustrate something to us. And what it is illustrating is that the number it's trying to give you is too large to fit in the column with. And one of the things that's very nice about the way this calc is done is it's very easy to change the size and the way columns are shaped. And all I have to do is point at this line here and move it over a bit. And automatically, it looks like
the point is, emulate what you do rather than ask the person, is it, first of all, can I even change the size of the column? And if I can't, what was that command? Was it a G? Was it a B? Was it a W? Sort of a two, to reach up there to the, you know, it's like erasing the column and moving it over to the right. That's exactly what we do.
The other thing that's very nice about Lisa Calc is if you want to change the formats within any columns or rows or any cells, there's a format capability to change it to whatever style you would like. So if I want to make sure that dollar sign is leading, I can come down here and ask to put in the dollar signs. I can also ask to center in the column.
Just click in the column heading up top. Up top.
Yes.
Yeah, there you go. And now all the functions will operate on everything that's in that particular column. And of course you can cut and paste and move columns around and rows, etc. But again, we don't have enough time to kind of go through all the capabilities. What we kind of wanted to show you is the user interface, some of the subtleties in terms of the intuitive ways of doing things, and show you a little bit of the integration. But you can change the fonts. One of the things that we may want to mention now is the scrolls.
Yes.
Just to give you an idea of how scrolling works in the system.
In fact, all of the folders are set up in the same way, and you've probably noticed these little boxes and arrows on the side of them, and they always deal with the data in the same way. You can scroll across a document by just pointing to the arrow and asking it to move in that direction. And again, move in the other direction. If you want to move a page at a time, which is very helpful when working in a word processing document, you hit this little thing that looks like the corner of a page, and it will move you a page at a time. Finally, if you want to move to some place within a document, you kind of know that it's about halfway through the document, but you're not quite sure where, you can grab this little thing that we call an elevator and move it down to about halfway down the column, and it will automatically move you down there. Now, in Lisa Calc's case, there are 256 by 256 matrix. And so moving halfway down, you can see the row numbers are now around 130 area and move back. It's very, very quick. You're back where you want to be. One of the other nice things about the way the applications are put together is being able to move data from one application to another it can be very cumbersome with a lot of computers. And one of the things we'd like to do is take some of the data out of Lisa Calc and move it into Lisa Graph, which is our graphing application. In order to do that, one thing I should probably do is shrink this down and then open up the document that I've put aside, which is in Lisa Graph, and it's called this graph right here. Notice that when I selected this folder, it now comes to the front of my stack of paper. And if I were to go back and select the spreadsheet, notice that it would now become active and would also come to the front. You can tell the active folder because it's reverse video on the name of it, and it's also now has the scroll bars and I can work with it. And one of the nice things about that is you can always take a folder and move it any place on the screen. And if you want to get to one, all you have to do is click on it and it'll bring it to the front no matter what else happens to be on top of it at that point in time. So why don't we go open the Opus Graph?
What we're going to do now is give you an idea of what we mean by the software architecture, in the sense that we're going to load two independent applications and we're going to take data from one document to another. And the real important thing here, I think, to remember is that the architecture that we've built, it's really independent in terms of those two applications, what applications that we pick. And we designed the software in such a way that we have what we call the Lisa Toolkit that will allow third-party software houses to create applications, create documents, if you will, of a particular type that would be used in this environment. So we could very easily here have an accounting package and be cutting data, if you will, out of the general ledger for the accounts receivable into the business graphics or into the word processing document.
Now, what we've done is we have both folders on the screen so we can illustrate how we'd be moving data back and forth in these environments. What I'll first do is click on the LisaCal folder to make it active and so that I can manipulate data in it. And I'll go over and select the total and the budget columns from the data we've created and go back to the edit menu. And what I'd like to do is make a copy of that. And so I ask it to make a copy, and what it does is there's a clipboard icon somewhere under all this. And what it does is it takes a copy of whatever I had selected and copies it onto the clipboard. And now I'll move down into Lisa Graph. And I'll select the spot where I'd like that data pasted, right there. And I'll go back and ask it to paste, and it will take it off the clipboard and paste it into this application for me. Now.
You just move data from one process, if you will, from one application to another. Those are not the same application. There's an architecture underneath this system that allows that. And so, you know, we don't really talk about applications, we don't talk about processes, we basically talk about our document types and moving data from one document to another. And that's the way it works consistently throughout the system.
Now, the way this graphing document works is it'll automatically plot out the data for me based on a format that I can specify. One of the interesting things about Lisa Graph is it's basically got two windows on it. The left-hand window is a set of cells which contain the data that you'd like to plot, and the right-hand side shows the graph that you'd like to plot. One of the things I can go in is change these legends that I've set up, and the way you change text in any application is always the same. And the way you do that is to go and select it, and I can press down on the mouse and select that piece of data, and then I want to be total, so I'll just type over it, total, and it'll automatically change that piece of text for me, and go into legend 2 and say I want that to be the budget numbers, and I can type in budget. Automatically modify that for me. Additionally, I can change the format of the graph to make it more intuitive if that's something I'd like to do. And I can make it a line chart if I'd like, and it automatically comes up very, very quickly, as you can notice.
You got a messy desk there. Why don't you move that document up and enlarge it a little bit so that we
that's
can
see
it.
That's a great idea, really. It's going to get cluttered. So what I'll do is move it up here and use the grow box. Throw it down to take up the rest of my screen.
Stretch it out.
And I will have a much better idea of what the plot looks like.
I'd like to see that data that you cut out of that model. Can you show me more of that data?
Sure thing. Actually, the two windows can be changed in size very easily. This little black line down here, all I have to do is grab it and move it over. And it will now allocate me a little more space over here to see my data, and it'll automatically readjust the size of the chart to fit in the window that I have here. One of the nice things about the system, though, is that even though this will shrink and grow based on what size I allocated to it on the screen, it will always print out based on the size that I specified in the model. So if I go up here in the page layout, I can change and make this a full-size graph or a half page, and it will always print out based on that, even though I've currently selected reduce to fit, so I'll always be able to see it as I make modifications to it. Now let's say that I wanted to go back and, you know, maybe play around with the way the plot is done and think a scatter plot might look nice. Or go back and say I want a line chart, but I want the budget to be shown as a line as opposed to a bar. I can go to the customize menu and say show as line, and it'll show the budget plotted as a line and show the bars as my actual. So I can have a very good idea doing financial analyses of where I am versus budget and that sort of thing. I could also go back and say I'd like to make a pie chart. It'll very quickly turn it into a pie chart form. And one of the nice things about the Lisa applications is that as you move data from Lisa Calc into Lisa Graph, we can also now take this pie chart and copy it into the clipboard and move it into an application which we call Lisa Draw, which is our freeform graphics application, and manipulate it and annotate it and make it look a little prettier for a presentation. I can do that very easily.
Yeah, let's just change the graph a little bit. You know, I think it's important to realize that you can change the data not only within this document,
sure,
but within the spreadsheet document. So you can go up there and change one of those values just by selecting it and see the graph, back change.
Something we could do is, let's say we just found out that our number of employees was going to change and we wanted to update that graph based on it. what I'll do is click back and open up my lease account document and say, gee, we're going to have 13 employees in the first quarter. I'd like to see how that changes my graph. And so what I'll do is take that data and now go back and select it again and copy it. And then move into my lease graph document and say I'd like to paste it in there. Now, not only will it paste it for me, but it's updated my plot automatically.
Yeah, and go ahead and change one of those values, change the fourth quarter value just right there.
And just as easily, we could have, if we know what the change is, we could modify this to $520. And it automatically would plot it for us as well. So you can either go back to the model that you used to create it, or if you know what the data is, and it's easy enough to do it, just come in here and change the number, and automatically it'll update your plot. Everything happens in real time very, very quickly. And so you don't have to wait to see what your plot looks like and to worry about whether the numbers are going to be the way you like them.
And everything that you see on the screen can be printed by simply going up to the menu bar where the print command is, and that's it. You say print. And you can select different types of resolutions in your print. You can have a quick draft, you can have a high resolution, et cetera, et cetera.
In fact, one of the nice things about the way the printer's set up is we can go to this line here that says format for printer, and we get a thing that we call a dialog box. And it says, well, in the past, you wanted to print out on a dot matrix printer with 11-inch paper in portrait mode as opposed to landscape, both of them supported in normal or high res. And it allows you to go in and actually change any of these if you like. And as you change them, it also modifies some of the assumptions that go in. Like when I click on Daisy Wheel, it now shows the print wheels that I have available. And I can change the print wheel. If I go back to dot matrix, obviously you're not using print wheels, so that goes away. And I could ask, if I change the paper to 14-inch paper, I could say I'd like to print out 14-inch paper, and it'll understand that and make sure that my document's resized for that. And I can just tell this to go over and done. Now all I'd have to do is go over and say print, and it would actually go ahead and print that out for me. One thing we didn't mention is, John did mention that the concept of visual fidelity is something that's been very important in Lisa. The concept of what you see is what you get is an extremely important preset of the project. And the printers will both print both text and graphics just the way it's on the screen. And that's kind of nice. What I'll do, as I was saying a little while ago, I'll select this graph. Let's say we want to modify it. I'll go back and I'll copy the graph.
Select
it first. Won't let me do something. I'm not allowed to. So I'll select all the graph and go ahead and copy that. And now I'll set aside this document. And to set aside, you can either do it two ways. One is to go to the file print menu and ask it to set it aside. And I'll do that for you.
That'll basically sort of close your document and set it on your desk in sort of an iconic form. What we're going to do is we're going to now take this graph and move it over to another package called LisaDraw. And what I'd like to do is take a few minutes here and sort of make a comment. Up to this point, in terms of designing software, we have always thought of the functionality, if you will, of the system being equivalent to the functionality of the application. And that is, we would always continue to try and add more function to the specific application. With this type of an architecture, with this type of software, with this integrated software, designing software becomes a little bit different than it has in the past, in the sense that you now have to ask yourself the question, how much functionality do you put in the individual application versus the functionality that you get from integration? I think the best example of that at this particular time is how much functionality do we want to put into the business graphics package? Yeah, my business graphics could do a pie chart, but can it do a three-dimensional pie chart? Can it take a piece of the pie out, move it into the right-hand corner, change the shades, change the text style, annotate it, edit it in any way? And, you know, you don't want to build all that into the business graphics package itself, because that starts to make it a little bit more complicated, but you want that functionality from the integration. So the point that I'm trying to make here is very simply, as we design software in an integrated environment like this in the future, we're going to get certain functionality from the integration. It's sort of a two-layer. Some functionality from the application, and additional functionality from the integration of moving data, if you will, from one document, that is application, into another document or application. And that's what Doug is going to show you here, is that we made the trade-off, rather than putting everything into the Lisa graph, that we created a package called LisaDraw, that sort of allows you to create any type of freeform graphics, org charts, layouts, anything, and it had an editing capability, and we used the cut and paste in terms of taking the business graphics over into LisaDraw to edit our graphs.
One of the first things you'll notice in bringing up this document, we call it presentation, is that it looks a little different than most documents within Lisa. And the thing that's different is this left-hand column over here. And what we like to think of these as are a palette of types of objects that you're allowed or are able to create on screen. And the way you work in LisaDraw is you dip your mouse in the particular type of object that you want to create, and then actually go ahead and draw it on the screen. And before I use any of these, I'd like to bring up that pie chart that I put away. And if I've done everything just right, when I say paste, it should bring it back for me. There it is. Now what I can do is actually go in and modify the pie chart. And there are a number of things I'd like to do first. One is I'd like to explode this segment of the pie out. And all I can do is grab it with the mouse and move it. And as I move it, it'll re-put it any place I like.
Again, all he does is point to an object and holding the mouse button, move it. It's the same sequence that we went through in the desktop, the same sequence that we went through in taking data from one package to another. Straightforward, you know, user interface.
One of the things we hadn't mentioned is whenever you select an object, the system always wants you to know that it's selected. In the case of text, you probably notice that it will just highlight it for you, let you know what you've selected. In the case of objects, it's a little different. What we've done is put handles on it. And each of these little squares here is a handle, and you can resize any object by just grabbing the handle and moving it. In the case of the wedge right now, what we'd like to do is first of all, create another one so we can create a drop shadow sort of effect. So all I have to do is go to the menu here and say duplicate, and it will duplicate that wedge for me. And let's say that I want it to be nice and dark, so I can go to the shades menu, of which you've noticed I have quite a few to choose from. And let's say I'd like to make it real nice and dark, so I select the black shade, and it'll modify that for me. Now, the thing that looks a little funny right now is if you want to create a three-dimensional effect, you normally want that to be in the back. And the way LisaDraw creates objects is just like pieces of paper, one on top of the other. And so I go to the arrangement menu and take the selected object and say send it to the back. And now it'll bring that other wedge out and put it on top for me. In addition, let's say I wanted to change the boldness of any of these lines. I can go in and actually select everything by just pressing down the mouse, and notice it's drawing a little box, and it will select everything inside that box for me. Those little objects' handles are there to show that they're selected. And I can go in and say I want to change the line style and make them a little thicker. And go in and modify all the lines for me. In addition to changing the line styles, I can also move text around very easily and create a new text. But let's say I want to take this project and move it over there. And take expenses and move it over there. And let's say that it really doesn't do it justice and I want to change the font style on some of these. I can go to type style and I have a choice of quite a few different kinds of font styles. And let's say I don't want to use the quarter inch modern that I'm in, but a more classic version of that. I can go and select that and automatically modify the typeface in the quarter inch classic. Let's say it's not quite large enough, so I'm going to set that off and go to third inch classic as well. And automatically modify that for me, and I can do the same over here. Now let's say that I was putting together a presentation and I wanted to annotate this document a little bit more. First I'm going to take the third quarter and change the type style just a bit. And then move it and put it inside the wedge. It's done. Very, very easy. Let's say I don't like the fill style on that particular wedge because I can't see it very well. The shadowing, I can just change the fill style and automatically change the document for me. In addition, let's say that I wanted to put a line across here to sort of set everything off. I can go over and choose the line palette, which will allow me to draw horizontal or vertical lines. And let's say I'd like to make a little thicker line. And just point the mouse where I want to start and push it across until I want to finish. And I've got a line. And I can move that line any place I like on the screen to make sure it sets just right with where I'd like the document to look.
Getting the idea?
addition to doing this sort of annotation, we can also draw boxes and any sort of non-standard, non-straight objects and multi-sided objects very, very easily. And modify any of these just by grabbing the handles and changing the shape of it. So it's very, very easy to work with Lisa Draw. Now that we've basically beat Lisa Draw to death, why don't I go on and open up the document which we previously wrote a memo concerning this project in, and that's in the Lisa Write application.
Yeah, well, you know, the capabilities of that, of the Lisa Draw package are just, you know, too numerous. But from my own standpoint, that turns out to be the package that I use myself the most, because I plan myself, you know, giving presentations to the board of directors, giving presentations to at the executive staff, trying to get 300 people to move in the same direction. So most of my day-to-day is what I call management by walking around, and it's lots of presentations, and so I use Lisa Draw to create overhead materials. And I no longer have to be content with waiting for my graphics department, which is sort of a batch operation, to turn something in and get something back 2 weeks late, and it's expensive. I've sort of redefined my associates' job functions to include being able to create very, very artistic graphics in 5 minutes or less. And again, you know, did you set that aside, or did you close it down? Okay, so you set it aside on the package. And that's that particular package, Lisa Draw itself, is also unique on not only on most computers, but certainly on personal computers. You haven't seen that type of capability in terms of presentation graphics before.
Now, what we've done here is opened up a document that I created earlier, and it's got a memo and a budget that we've taken out of LisaCal. One of the interesting things, and very different things about Lisa's word processor, LisaWrite, is that we don't have keys to move the cursor around on the screen. If you want to go somewhere in a document, you just move the mouse there and click it, and it'll put this little flashing bar there to let you know where you are. And to insert text, all I have to do is type from there, and it'll insert the text for me. If I wanted to, let's say I want to put a heading on this budget here, I could easily just mark in a spot and type in Opus budget. And I can spell it wrong. Actually, why don't I just leave it that way and I'll show you how to edit something. To edit out the mistakes that I made, I just go in with the mouse and select the text that I want. Selecting is done just like it is anywhere else within Lisa. You point at the place you want to start, and you move the mouse until you find the place you want to stop. So if I want to select all of this, I just keep moving. In this case, I just want to cut out those two letters, so I go over there and I go to the edit menu and I say cut, and it'll be gone. That's correct. Let's say that I wanted to have it centered over my budget just to make it look a little better. I can go to the format menu until it's centered. And it will do that for me, and let's say I want to make it a little bigger. So I'll go to the type style menu and say I want to use quarter and moderate. It'll automatically give me that.
You notice that you know, all he does is he sort of scans that menu bar, and you can kind of take a look at all the capabilities, all the function methods that are available at that particular time for that particular document, for that particular selection. And so you can kind of look through the system and say, I never tried that, let me try that. And that's how you learn about additional capabilities if you're like me in terms of not wanting to read a manual.
Let's say if I wanted to take this text, that within each text file, I also can do a number of different things. I can underline it, I can italicize it, and I can make boldface. And you can do that with any text within Lisa. It'll automatically just do that for you. In order to move text around within Lisa, right, let's say I wanted to take this paragraph down here, and I meant to put it up here, and I kind of blown it and added it at the last minute. I can select this entire paragraph by just coming down with the mouse and moving down to select it. There are also a few shortcuts in Lisa. If you double click on a word, you'll get the word, and if you triple click, you'll get the paragraph. So it's very easy to select things very, very quickly. And let's say I wanted to move that, so I'll have to go to the edit menu and use the same commands I've been using all night, which are cut and paste. I'll cut it out. I'll give it a spot to where I'd like it to go. next to that. So there, I can also go in and modify. You notice how I changed the text style in Locus Code. I can change the type style of any text by just selecting it and actually going in and changing it. If I want to make it smaller, I can make it smaller. In addition, let's say that I go back and make that readable for you. Let's say that I want to get rid of that paragraph altogether, but I want to type something else in there instead. One of the precepts of Lisa is that you select and then type if you want to change something. So now I've selected the paragraph. I don't actually have to go and cut it. If I want to put in a new paragraph, I can just say this is a new paragraph. And it'll automatically remove what I had there and put in the new paragraph for me. Basically, that's most of what I wanted to show you in Lisa Wright. Again, there are little shortcuts that you learn as you go through the system. One way, as opposed to asking me to set this document aside, I can double click on this little symbol up here. And notice what will happen. I'll get what we call a dialog box, which is asking me exactly how I want to deal with something. And basically what it's saying is, did you make a mistake? Do you really want to put it aside? And if you do, do you want to set it aside on your desktop so you can use it later? Or do you actually want to put it back away in the file cabinet from which it came from? In my case, I'll click set aside on the text, put it aside on the screen. And notice it'll put it right up here on the screen so I can get at it. If I'd asked to put it away, I would put it back away from the folder that it came from. Last thing we'd like to do is go and open up a document that we created on Lisa List, which is a list manager application. And in this case, why don't we open it up and create a distribution list set for the memo that we just created.
You keep a pretty clean list.
Yeah, it becomes a habit after a while. One of the nice things, though, is if you don't keep a clean desk, one of the menu items of the file print is to set aside everything. And it will take virtually every folder that's active on or open on your screen and set it aside for you so that you can get rid of it and deal with it some other time. One of the other things that's very interesting about Lisa that we haven't talked about is the way the software is used to control the hardware. As you noticed when we put in the diskette earlier on, before it would actually eject the diskette, it had to put aside all the documents that initially came on that diskette. One of the other things that happens with Lisa is when you shut the machine off, you virtually don't power it down. What you do is you press that little white button and you say, I'd like you to shut down. And what it'll do is it'll bring up the dialog box and say, we're putting aside all of the documents that you've been working on prior to shutting down. And then you'll notice them go into the file cabinet. And then when you fire it up the next morning, it'll put all the documents back on your screen where you left them the night before. So if you're working on something and want to shut it down, it's very easy to do that because you know the next morning it'll bring up the document in your desktop just the way you did it before. Getting into this document, in Lisa's list manager, you're able to create lists and do searches and sorts in order to modify them. In this case, we've got a list of a number of employees and a number of things about them. And creating the list that we want, the distribution list, we can do a number of things. When I go to the list menu, I can ask it to find particular employees for me. Like, let's say I want the distribution to only be the people on the marketing council. What I'll do is I'll go and select that cell. And again, you select the cell just by clicking on it and say yes, because I want everyone to be on the marketing council. And then I can come up here and say, find the show. And it'll actually give me my list showing people who are only on the marketing council. Again, as in all documents, you can change the type style. Like let's say I have a very large list and I want to shrink it down, I can choose a smaller type style just so it can be viewed a little easier. And again, now let's say I wanted to create that mailing list. Now I've got everyone on the marketing council, but I don't really want all this garbage on the mailing list. I just want the names of the people on the mail stuff. So I can go in and ask what order of format, and it will allow me to specify a number of things about my mailing list. First thing, I want to make some of my columns invisible so that people don't see where they came from. So I can click on the cell over here and ask the column to become invisible. And move over to the next column and I want that to be invisible as well. And in fact, I don't really care what department they're in either, so I'll ask them to make that one invisible. But let's say that instead of sorting alphabetically, I would like, you know, for my own edification, it'd be easier to sort by mail stuff. What I can do is click on sort order, and it will give me a choice of ascending or descending order. In this case, I'd like to be ascending. And I can ask for that. And now I can go back and set, show what's in order. And it'll show me the sorted list that I just created, and it will put it in order of mail stop for me. And there it is. And I'm ready to go. Now set this document aside and just, again, double click on the form, and I'll set it aside on my desktop. Now, before I put these away, is there anything else you'd like to do, Joe? Okay, now let's say I'd like to take all these and put them back in this folder that I call Boston Computer Society. First, I'll close down that folder. And I can kind of walk through what we've just done today, which is really quite a lot in a short period of time. And I think you've all noticed that I've probably only touched the keyboard 3 or 4 times throughout this whole presentation. We've moved, modified, and changed a lot of data with just using the mouse. And to kind of walk through what we've done is we've illustrated a project schedule that we created for this project, worked on a budget, actually graphed out some of the information from the budget, cut that into a presentation drawing and annotated it, moved around the pie chart a bit, wrote a memo on that, and then created a list to send them all to. And all I have to do to put those away is grab it and move it on top of that Boston Computer Society folder. You'll notice that it's on top because it made it black, lit up on the mouse, and it will now put all those away for me.
So now it's backing up every document that was created. A couple of things that I'd like to kind of point out, and when you have the lights, one of the things that we didn't have a chance to show you was a feature that we call stationary pads. And these I found to be the most useful to me. And what a stationary pad is, if you're all familiar with, whether it's blank paper or those little memo pads where it sort of has a predefined grid
on it to send to, or so-and-so called and call back or whatever. You can take any one of these documents that we had, that we've shown you today, and take any of the data and create a stationary pad from it. So, for instance, you can create forms, you can create letterheads. One of the ones that I happen to like is one of the people got creative and drew a three-dimensional sort of map of the United States. Well, I made that stationary pad. So that now whenever I want to, talk about the distribution cycles or sales in a particular area as far as a graph, I now have a stationary pad for, a three-dimensional view of the United States, and I just need to sort of enter my data. That's one of the powerful features. The other thing that we didn't mention, and then I'd kind of like to summarize, is the garbage can. As you throw things into the garbage can, we sort of leave them there, and you can retrieve them. Like all offices, the janitor comes by at some time and empties that garbage can out. We empty it out when you actually, one of the documents that you need will need the memory, will take the memory from the document that you threw in the garbage can. So the other feature is there's some undo commands in there so that you can kind of undo the mistakes that you've made at least one level. But I hope that gave you an idea of the system, the user interface, the integration, the different approach that we have taken in terms of personal computers. I'm actually relieved because for 18 months I've been having to go around and talk about the future direction in software technology and without showing a demo like that. And so it's kind of nice to be able to show a demo, to show the system, and to exhibit it. Kind of in summary, if you will, I'd like to sort of just, again, to kind of review the technology. What has transpired in the last 3 or 4 years that has allowed us to do something like this? And if you'll think of a pyramid with 3 levels, I'd like to sort of to address that. The base of the pyramid being the foundation that this software is sitting on is the hardware technology. And there's three aspects of that hardware technology that, that is now and available to us today. The first is the 32-bit architecture, the 68,000, the power of the processor, not only in terms of its speed, but its ability to address more memory. And what we chose to do, as I mentioned earlier, was rather than run traditional software a little bit faster on a more powerful processor, was take the speed and the capability of that processor and the memory addressability of that processor and give it to the user. Give it to the user in terms of a much easier to use system, not only from the user interface standpoint, but from the integration standpoint. The second aspect of that is the multitasking operating software that we can now put on that particular hardware. It was very difficult to do multi-processing operating systems on 8-bit processors. And what we have designed here is not necessarily what I would consider a timeshare system or a multi-user system, but we've taken those multiple processes and give them to the single user so that you can print in background a 20 or 30 page report at the same time that you're generating presentation graphics or making lists or answering your phone. And then the third technology is that we took advantage from a hardware standpoint is that resolution of that screen, that bitmap screen in terms of bitmaps rather than characters. At the top of the pyramid, if that's the foundation of the pyramid, the top of the pyramid are three things that I feel are generic to all personal office systems. Those are the series of software that you've seen today in terms of spreadsheeting and drawing and word processing. But in addition to those, there's two other important aspects. One is datacom. Because, you know, face it, most of the data in the world doesn't get created at the keyboard of your personal computer. It already exists. In my case, the data for the personal office systems division in terms of our sales and our expenditures is sitting on a corporate machine. And so we have built a package called Lisa Terminal, which fundamentally allows, it acts as a VT100, VT52, glass CRT, or a teletype, and it allows me to go into that, which our central system, which happens to be a 1170, download the data that's sitting on that 1170 into a document, and then cut that information from that document into another document. We're also working on 3270 BISync and 3270 SNA, and they go beyond the just, hey, here's your screen, and here, you're acting like a 3270 terminal, but our goal is to put them into that Lisa environment, if you will, such that all the information that's captured in that sequence of talking to that central computer is in a document, and that information can be cut, just like you saw it today. And then the third aspect, which is sort of on the top of this pyramid, is networking, in the sense that, you know, we believe in one person, one computer, but we all also work in an organization, and we share the data. And therefore, the integration that we talk about should not be limited just to cutting data from one document to another on my desk, but I ought to be able to take documents and transfer them to somebody else's desk. And therefore, the network is important. So if you look at the base hardware that we've built this on and the kind of capability that we want on the top, then there's this thing in the middle. Newsweek referred to us as the magicians at Apple. So let me just call that portion in the middle the Lisa magic. And that Lisa magic, I think you've seen tonight, is number one is that user interface, that, you know, the ability for us to get somebody up and running on this machine and producing useful results in 22 minutes, which is the data that we've gotten over the years of studies in Los Angeles and Paris and Chicago with sort of blind neophyte people who've never used computers before. The desktop manager in terms of doing away with a command interpreter as a programming language. The integration, that ability to create data structures, if you will, such that when you want to pass a spreadsheet information into the word processor understands numerics. And these, you know, so you're not just dealing with integer data types and doing add and subtract on integer data types anymore. You're dealing with some very sophisticated data structures, and you're mapping those data structures from one application, if you will, to another. And the visual fidelity, that is what you see on the screen is what you're going to get out on the printer, on that $700 printer. And so that to us is sort of the Lisa magic. That's the architecture that we refer to, the openness in the sense that we will provide these tools to third-party software houses and major accounts so they too can add additional software, take advantage of that user interface, take advantage of that cut and paste. And I guess sort of summarize it, we set out, Steve and I, set out to do to provide sort of a very build, if you will, something that we ourselves wanted. We ourselves that we would feel proud to build and to own. And that led to its revolutionary nature. In addition to that, I'm going to share with you tonight sort of Steve and my own sort of private goal. And that was we wanted our competition, that is those people who understood the technology, who understood the difficulty in terms of creating that Lisa magic, we wanted to sort of blow their minds. And so Steve and I sort of had this private goal that I really haven't spread around, but we wanted to introduce a product that not only was revolutionary, that allowed people, you know, like my wife and my father to use computers, but we wanted to build a product so that when that competition saw it, they would only have one reaction, and that would be, aw, shit. Okay, do you guys want to come on up? Want to take some questions? Yeah, bring the guys up. Come on up. Where's Washburn? This is Apple, man. I think you've seen, you know, very little of the product tonight, and we are rolling about 600 units out into the field in the next 6 weeks. The dealers that will be carrying the product, the professional office systems dealers, should have their units by the end of February. And I suggest that if you really want to understand this particular product and the capabilities, you have to use it. And you kind of have to drive it. Okay, I guess we have time for a few questions. So I'll just open that up. Who's Lisa? Oh, okay, that's a... Let me tell you the true story about this. We originally, back in 1978, we named all of our, we had code names for all of our products. And the code names, we were always getting on the same damn airplane that Atari was getting onto, going to Las Vegas or whatever. So we decided to code name all of our products so that we could talk about our products. And since we were young, energetic gentlemen in those days, we figured we were always talking about women anyway, so we would name all of our products about, you know, with women's names, based on either our wives or our friends or whatever. That way, when we got on the airplane, you know, we'd say, hey, how's Lisa doing? How's Annie doing? How's Sarah doing? You know, that's you know. And we sort of kept that. Lisa was the original code name for the product, the hardware designer's wife's name is Lisa, et cetera. And we kind of got farther down the line, and I think Apple, we eventually switched to types of Apple names in terms of Pippins and Macintoshes and all these kinds of things. But we got down to the wire in terms of, as the product started to evolve, you know, and it started to develop its own personality, and we all got very much enamored with it, the marketing recommendation was to call the product Apple 400. And there was just something inside of a lot of us that we just couldn't quite get too excited about Apple 400. It didn't represent the nature, the personal aspect nature of the product. And we had an awful hard time in writing the data sheets. And you know, there's some literature in the back, and you'll see our data sheets. We've gone with purple, you know, the passionate color of the 80s. And as you started writing about the Apple 400 and what it could do, it was, you know, people just kept going back to the code name, which was Lisa. And we had an acronym very early in the game. It originally stood for Large Integrated Software Architecture, but we changed it to Local Integrated Software Architecture as the networking and as the datacom became more and more apparent that those were fundamental capabilities. And so, given the acronym, and it really represents, I think, the technology of the product in terms of local. It's a personal computer. It belongs on your desk. You don't go down the hall to use it. Integrated, you know, the concept of the integration of moving data from one document to another. And then the software architecture, because this product, the market that is opening because of this product is opening because of the software technology. Not the hardware technology, but the software technology. And I think, you know, to kind of sum it up, when I was in Paris and I was talking to a fellow who runs the sort of the advanced development for the largest French software house, which is more than $100 million, and he kind of said to me, you know, he looked at the product and he said, you know, if we're not developing software like this within 3 years, we're out of business. And so, you know, it sort of sets the tone, if you will, for the kind of software I think that we're going to see throughout the 1980s in terms of graphic, the doing away with command interpreters and this type of stuff. And so I was one of the first times I ever sort of overrode what the director of marketing indicated we should call the product and made a, you know, sort of a gut decision that said we're going to call the product Lisa. And I really feel that's the right thing to do, and I was glad to see there was an article in the local paper the other day, and it had gone through about how Lisa was going to change the computer world and the use of computers, and how the individuals in the 80s were going to get this, the manual transmission thing again. And he sort of ended it up and he said, you know, Lisa's a strange name for a revolution, but so was Apple 2 years ago. Yes. In the third-party program. Okay. Needless to say, there's a lot of software in this particular package. In fact, I think when we introduced the Apple II, there were 16,000 bytes of software associated with the introduction. When we introduced the Apple III, there were about 200,000 bytes. There's over 2 million bytes of software associated with this. So we had a tremendous task in terms of testing that particular software. And I put together a special group of people that report directly to me who are responsible for really moving the state of the art in software testing. And we built tools like, I guess the best way to, coverage analyzers. In a sense, if you take a look at a piece of software and all the instructions are white, and as you start to go through that software and test all the boundary conditions and all the parameters and all the different functions, they start to change color, say to blue. And you run all of your stuff, you sit down and you use it for 5 weeks or whatever in the background, you're changing these instructions to blue. And then you step back from the system and you find out that 25% of your instructions are still white, but you haven't gone through that type of code. But we built two tools like that that would give us that type of data so that we could have canned applications, both that were generated from a sort of a batch environment as well as a script environment in terms of just modeling people. And we created these things that all can be automatically run on our software to ensure that we had 95% coverage of the software. So that's sort of the approach that we took there. The third-party software houses. Again, I was the original vice president of software for Apple. We started really, you know, I can remember the day that I took over that job and got a letter from the board of directors, which was written in the margin of our price list that said, software price list that said, this is pitiful, move fast, good luck. And so we put together a program to really go out to the third-party software houses to try to communicate to them that, you know, they were going to, the return on their investment because size of the customer base and the personal computer was going to be so much greater than what they were writing software for in the minis. And, you know, we put together a toolkit. The original toolkit consisted of an assembler, 6502 assembler. We then moved to a Pascal development environment, and we've been growing that ever since. Well, this toolkit for this product represents the same growth and capabilities that the software does. And that toolkit will be available by the end of the year, will allow people to install applications into this environment and cut and paste and use the pull-down menus and the multiple processes and the windows, et cetera. I already have approximately 50 machines in software houses today. And I think you'll start to see some of the introductions. Some of the original introductions are some other environments that are important. Xenix environments and some CPM environments.
What sort of networking package are you going to be offering with it besides what was?
What do you think the new package?
You get the local area network package?
Well, they're all bundled in, so we haven't really priced it separately.
Yeah, new stuff as it comes out.
Oh, neat. It's going to be
long.
Oh,
no.
Oh, no.
Let's see.
We're running it, even though we won't ship it until the fall, we're actually testing the machines with an
infinity. Divide by zero, it gives you infinity.
Yes.
It says infinity.
It'll come out with basic, it'll come out with Pascal, it'll come out with Cobol.
It's better than error.
Yeah, you shouldn't have pressed that one.
Yep.
What's the reboot button?
Just in other words, you're either in the Lisa world or you're in the Xenix world.
We didn't even touch the keyboards.
There's no half open Apple and half
really? Really? No, somebody touched the keyboard.
In other words, that's up to
you. What?
Somebody.
Is that what they get?
They write Xenix.
How do you reboot this machine?
It's got to have a boss. It's got to have something to turn the encoders.
Get an expert
well, some people build optical
just gave a system
somebody claimed they hit a number key when it was in the calculator
program.
Get all the good stuff.
Doug.
Certainly Doug. 68,000, isn't it?
You better get the expert. Doug Pollock.
Keep has grown to
1.84. Hey, John.
Does that ball roll?
Yeah.
Oh, I see. It has to be.
It's like a track ball.
See if you can take a look at it. Yeah. If you bring it to this group, you know that's going to happen.
Just need to reboot it.
Let me get around it, please.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Rolling against the other two.
Market check.
Are the wheels that hit the wall, are they the sensors, or how's it going?
An X and a Y roller, which drive a slotted wheel, breaks a light beam, and it generates interrupts.
Functionally equivalent.
Generates interrupts.
How much does that cost to build?
Got me.
Uh-huh.
I have no idea.
People sell them for $400.
All in flying tests, they're okay.
Correct. You can set up macros underneath those keys. People make them with, you put a grid down and keys program.
Oh, but that's like a bit pack. Like a BitPad, tab, graphics tab.
No, they have a thing called an optical mouse where you look at a photo sensor.
We've run 50 machines together at this.
Red lights on. What? Okay, there you go.
Let's see.
There you go.
Let's see.
There's a divide by zero there.
Problem with my calculator program.
How big are the hard disks?
Was that straightened up the desk?
Yeah. 5 megabytes.
Is that a single converted diskette?
How is this different from the diskette?
Well, you see, there's no right notch in here. There's a notch here, and there's a notch here, plus the corner is notched. So if you take a standard 5 1/4 inch floppy and put it in here, it won't go into it. Won't fit.
Here it is.
This is an 871,000 byte media per drive.
How is the graphics also done in Pascal, or is it special? Yeah,
everything is done in Pascal. I'm sure there's a lot of assembly language, 68,000 assembly language in there too, but primarily the language is Pascal.
Can you pick the cursor up and
so
turn it over?
Third-party software.
Two heads, opposite each other on the same side, which you get a lot of media wear. So what we use is a head and a pressure pad, and then another head and a pressure pad, and we reduce media wear.
So Apple designed the drive system.
Yes, it's Apple's design.
No, Elder.
Is that a standard available disk stack, or is it special?
The diskette, yeah. It's special, and I think there are two or three.
Verbatim and 3M
are coming out with the second source vendors to provide.
But it was developed by Apple.
Yeah,
later than normal.